we're at an important crossroads now, because we know more about how the mind and brain develop than we ever knew before. We're going to learn more in the next 10 and 20 years still. But it gives us an opportunity to redefine the standards of care for infants and children with severe developmental problems, including children with autistic spectrum disorders, but also other problems in relating and communicating, including severe language problems, severe regulatory problems, children with Down syndrome, Fragile X syndrome, fetal alcohol syndrome, cerebral palsy, and even severe forms of attention deficit disorder. Mm-hmm. So we're now in a position to really redefine how we work with these children. The older model did the best that it could under the circumstances, and the older model worked with surface behaviors, a lot of behavioral work just to modify how children behave, because that was better than ignoring children and better than doing nothing, or better than simply trying to contain their aggressive or withdrawn behavior. And in its time, for a long time, was the only approach available. And the fact that that pioneered intensity for kids was a very, very promising development, because it got people working intensively and got people feeling optimistic about what could be done. But now we can go beyond working on modifying behaviors and work on some of the underlying issues that are giving the children trouble. The other very older approach has been to work on circumscribed cognitive skills, to sort of take lessons from older children. If an older child is supposed to learn how to identify shapes, we'll take a three-year-old who has no language and work on matching shapes. And we'll do that in a kind of rote and repetitive way. Again, that's better than nothing. At least we're interacting with the child. At least we're doing some sort of encouragement of the child's cognition. But it's a piecemeal, isolated approach, working with this isolated cognitive skill, working with that isolated cognitive skill. And now, with our understanding of how the mind and brain grow, we can do much better. So we can go beyond these two older approaches of working with surface behaviors, modifying behaviors, or working with isolated cognitive skills. And we can really now begin to systematize what might be called a developmental approach that synthesizes and integrates all the best information we have about how the mind and brain grow. There are three insights, I think, of the last 20 years that are the cornerstones of our new way of working with infants and children with developmental problems. One of these is the importance of affect, emotions, and relationships for the growth of the brain and the mind. It used to be thought that you want a particular cognitive skill, you stimulate that cognitive skill. Now we know that the brain grows most rapidly in the early years as an outgrowth of interactions with caregivers. And these interactions have to have a number of features. They have to have the feature of warmth and security, also regulation, where the child is not overwhelmed. There has to be a lot of relatedness and engagement. There has to be a lot of back and forth emotional signaling and gesturing. There has to be problem solving. Then there has to be using ideas in a meaningful and functional way. Give me my juice. I want this. And then there has to be thinking. No, I won't go to sleep now. Well, why? Well, because I want to stay up. So we have to have lots and lots of interactions with children that have to do with exchanging emotions and have to do with a fundamental sense of relatedness. When we deprive children of this relatedness, we see children in orphanages and other settings, they don't grow. Language doesn't develop. Cognition doesn't develop. And we've seen in our observations and our studies that even the simplest task of learning how to say hello is dependent on our emotions and our relationships. A child doesn't learn to say hello based on rules. You only say hello to first-degree relatives, or only say hello to people who live in a quarter-mile radius of your house. You say hello because you feel a friendly emotional signal in your gut that signals trust or warmth, familiarity, and you wave and you say hello. If you feel something other than that, if you feel fear or anger, a child will hide behind mommy's leg and not say hello. It's not surprising that kids who are physiologically overwhelmed avoid and don't do the greetings, don't do the smile. So even something as simple as learning to say hello is signaled by our affects. But even something as complicated as math, to a 2.5 or 3-year-old, quantity concepts are learned not, again, by rote memory, by memorizing numbers, but by an emotional feel. A lot to a 3-year-old is more than you expect. A little is less than you want. Right. And that's also emotional. And just the basic concept that Piaget talked about of causality in an 8- or 9-month-old, the ability to learn to be logical, to make things happen. Piaget thought the child learned to pull a string to ring a bell, and this was basically a cognitive motor act. But we know that the baby is pulling on mommy or daddy's heartstring with their smiles and with their vocalizations, with their joyful vocalizations at 2, 3, and 4 months. And if they get a response back, they begin having circles of communication, causal interactions, means, ends, relationships, at 4 or 5 months earlier than Piaget thought in the emotional sphere. And this is because the child can control and regulate emotions and facial expressions that convey emotions much earlier than they can motor behavior. So emotions lead the way all the way through. They become especially important when we get to abstract thinking, like teaching a child a concept of justice or a concept of fairness. We found that a child has to have two levels to do that. One is a level of lived emotional experience. They have to experience the phenomena of being treated fairly and unfairly. Giving a child 6 apples and taking it away and giving it to his sibling teaches them quickly what unfairness is. And then they can label that and abstract off of that and create a category of things that are fair, things that are unfair. But they have to have the lived emotional experience in order to know what the concept is all about. So every word in our language has to be lived first to understand it. You don't define an apple by its redness and roundness. You define it by how it tastes and what it feels like to throw it. So language, cognition, math, quantity concepts are all conveyed through interactive relationships through affects. That's one important new insight. So we can't teach children in the old-fashioned ways anymore, particularly children with special needs who have processing problems. And this means working not only with the relation with the child, but the whole family pattern, because it's within the family context and actually the cultural and community context that these relationships and these emotional interactions occur. So it means a much broader relationship-based, family-based approach, cultural and community approach to children with special needs. The second new insight is that in the last 10 to 20 years, we've also figured out what the important underlying processing capacities are that are behind children's worrisome behavior. So we've understood how children are different, individually different, in the way they process sounds, auditory processing, and language, the way they process what they see, visual spatial process, whether the child can find a hidden object, whether the child can search for an object, whether a child understands that mommy is in the next room and I'm here and doesn't get panicked, whether a child understands even more when he's in school that mommy is not too far away and is only a few minutes away, a time concept as well as a spatial concept. It'll only take me 30 steps, you know, out this door and out that door to get to where mommy usually is. So auditory processing, language, visual spatial processing, also motor planning and sequencing. We find enormous variations in children in how they can plan actions. Some children can only do banging or can only put a car in a garage and take it out. Other children can take the car, put it in the garage, take it to grandmother's house, make a tea party at grandmother's house, and then bring the car back with some extra tea for mommy who's sitting back at the original house. So one child does a one-step, two-step, another child is doing a 6, 7-step action, planned action pattern. This we call motor planning and sequencing, which is enormously important for children. And we find a lot of the children with autistic spectrum disorders have severe problems with their motor planning and sequencing that underlies a lot of their repetitive behavior. Because if you can't plan and sequence, you're going to repeat.
Right.
So this is very, very important in understanding a lot of the symptoms. Also, we have observed that a lot of the kids have differences in the way they modulate sensation. Some kids are very overreactive to things like sound and touch, and they hold their ears, or they avoid and push away from people who try to tickle them. Other children crave sensory input, and they want more touch, and they want more noise. And some children have both the craving. They want more, but they get overloaded because they also have areas of sensitivity. And those children are very hard to find the right sensory pattern to pull them in and engage them. We find that a lot of children who are self-absorbed are underreactive to things like touch and sound. A lot of children who are very avoidant and keep running away from people, it's not because they don't love people, but it's because they're overreactive to things like touch and sound. So we need to look at the sensory modulation of the child to find the right pattern to pull that child into a relationship. So this is the second area of big insight, individual differences in the way the child processes their sensations and plans their motor actions. And this explains a lot of the surface behaviors. But if you work with the underlying processing differences, then you can influence many behaviors and help the child be adaptive across a broad range of issues rather than just work on isolated cognitive skills or isolated behaviors. And the third big area of insight based on our new research, is to understand what the early stages of development are. Historically, we thought of development in very isolated ways, motor development. We have a timetable for sitting up, for walking. Language development, when the first sounds are made, when the first words are made. For different areas of cognitive development, when a child searches in your hand for an object, when a child can stack blocks in a certain way, and so forth and so on. But each area has been separate. And social and emotional development, when a child will greet, when a child will play with peers, when a child will do some pretending. So we've had separate lines for each area of development, and those, as though these are somewhat independent of one another. But in fact, for the child, all these lines of development are interrelated. The child doesn't separate out their language, their motor skills. He doesn't say, well, I'm a four-year-old motor-wise, but I'm only a two-year-old language-wise, and only an eight-month-old social and emotionally. The child integrates all these in one smooth way. It's kind of like a basketball team. You've got to look at how the team plays together as an integrated unit. That determines whether the team wins or loses more than any individual player. Similarly, we haven't had a developmental roadmap for the team, for the mental team, language, cognition, affect, and emotions. In the last 10, 20 years, we've put together that what we call functional developmental roadmap, where we understand now the core levels that synthesize and integrate all the different developmental capacities. And we've identified six core levels and then additional ones beyond that that help us organize where we want to work with the child. And then we try to identify where the child is, not only in their language or motor development, which we do anyhow, but in their core functional developmental capacities. And then we meet the child where they are and work up the developmental ladder. And the six levels, just very briefly, are the ability for regulation and shared attention, which you need as a foundation, for engagement with warmth and trust and intimacy, for two-way purposeful communication, opening and closing circles of communication in a back-and-forth way with a lot of affective gesturing and micro-affective gesturing, smiles, smirks, head nods, the ability to take these gestures and organize them into problem-solving patterns. So we can actually take mommy by the hand, walk her to the refrigerator, bang on the door, and point to the juice. That may be 10 or 20 interactive gestures all targeted towards solving a problem. So that's our fourth stage, interactive problem solving use of gestures. And then the fifth stage is the functional use of ideas. In language, me hungry, juice please, or in pretend play, feeding the dollies, hugging the dollies. And the sixth level is the ability to build bridges between ideas. So you can use language logically and realistically and shift gears between reality and fantasy. So the child, when he says, I want to go out, and you say, why? Because I want to play. Or the dolly is having a tea party. Well, how come the dolly wants to have a tea party? Because the dolly is hungry, or because the dolly is having a birthday, and they like to have tea parties on their birthday. So now we have logical use of ideas supporting imaginative play and negotiating and problem-solving with the world, having debates, having problem-solving discussions at the symbolic level. So these are our six functional levels. And for each level, we can look at the particular motor skills and language skills and visual spatial processing skills that relate to that level, that are needed to support that level. And this gives us a much more integrated roadmap of development. So when we see a child now, we can figure out where they are in their functional level. So these three new insights also correlate very nicely with insights about the neurophysiology and the neuroanatomy and neurochemistry of the brain. Because interestingly, as we've done more brain imaging studies and more basic research from animal work, we know more than ever before that relationships and interactions and appropriate levels of stimulation is important for proper brain growth, not just mind growth. And also, interestingly, the stages of these functional stages we're talking about correlate nicely with how the brain gets myelinated. So for example, at around 8 to 12 months, the prefrontal cortex is becoming more and more myelinated. And that's the point at which purposeful interactions are gaining ascendancy and gaining strength. And the child can now motor plan well enough to reach for something, take it, hand it back. And it's just the time that the areas of the brain that allow that to happen are beginning to myelinate. So while we can't say that the relationship and the interaction stimulates brain growth, we do know, though, that when we deprive children of these interactions, the brain growth doesn't occur. What we can't say one stimulates the other, but they seem to occur right at the same time in optimal or ideal development. And what's been missed for a long time with our research colleagues in neuroscience, it's often been assumed that the environment operates like a little switch. Oh, language will come in if you just turn on the switch. In other words, you can't deprive a child entirely, you just have to give them a little bit of environmental nourishment, but any kind will do in any sort of family situation. From our work with children with autism and other development problems, we see that that doesn't happen with children with challenges, that they need very specialized environments. And there's a reason why children start talking with therapy or with a proper home program. Well, I think what the original observers ignored was the fact that in many of the families where there are not developmental challenges, these interactive patterns that support these six functional levels, engagement, interaction, signaling, problem solving, use of language in an imaginative and functional way, these things are happening automatically. And so they're taken for granted. And they're subsumed under the notion of just broad environmental support. There hasn't been awareness that the environmental support that supports proper brain growth is most likely very specific and supports each of these six functional areas. We see it in the children with special needs, and we see it also in children at environmental risk, where the environments are just very unavailable, very withholding, and very overstimulating. The children don't develop proper language cognition or emotional and social skills. And in normal development, where these things are developing, all these things are in place. The parents are supporting engagement and regulation and two-way communication and problem solving and creative use of ideas. So my hypothesis would be that the environment actually provides just as specific nutrients to the proper growth of the grain that our internal biology provides in terms of proper enzymes and proper biological pathways, that both have to be in place, the biological substrate and the experiential environmental. And the experiential environmental is much more specific than we ever realized before, and I think we've got a handle now on this roadmap that we can apply, and we have been applying, to children with special needs. And we've seen at least at a clinical level and a case study level and a systematic study of cases, children doing better than we ever expected when we apply this model. So we've been able to help children with severe language problems learn to speak if we first get them engaged and get them purposeful in their gestures, and then we build in the symbolic speaking and thinking capacities. If we try to do the speaking and thinking without the foundation pieces, without these early levels, it doesn't go as well. They have a bunch of splinter skills. So this, I think, tells us that this roadmap is very, very important. So this all translates, these new research and new insights translates into what we call a DIR model, which just summarizes these three areas of insight. D for functional developmental levels. We want to see where the child is in their development. I for individual differences in processing. What's their processing profile in terms of auditory processing, visual spatial, sensory modulation, motor planning? And R, what are their relationships like? What is the interactive use of affects like in the family now? And what would be the ideal pattern to support enhanced development? And what is the pattern we want in the therapeutic program at home and at school to support enhanced development? So this is why we call it a DIR model, because it looks comprehensively at the child. And it's an advance over the older ways of thinking, because we're not just focused on isolated cognitive skills, and we're not just focused on surface behaviors. We're focused on integrated understanding of human development from the point of view of interaction with the environment, internal biologically mediated processing differences, and the child's developmental roadmap in terms of determining where the child is. Now, as you and I have discussed many times, this now changes the way we do assessments and the way we plan interventions. Do you want to comment on how this has altered the way we approach the assessment process?
Well, one of the things I think we observed that often assessments were done based on these older views. Let's look at the speech milestones. Let's look at the motor milestones. Let's look at cognitive milestones. And children who actually had underlying difficulties that interfered with the ability to perform were being put through these formalized assessments. And that didn't really help you understand the child and how the child functions as a whole. So in our view, what we would do is really first look at how the child functions. And we want to see that functioning within those relationships that are most important for the child and with the people that he knows best. So we want to see the child interacting spontaneously with his mother, his father, other important caregivers. And that begins to give us the first picture of all these developmental capacities, because as you say, they are actually all functional at the same time. So by first making sure we have enough opportunity to observe a child and the family interacting, and to take the time to do that, to do it several times so that we really can cover the range, depending on what kind of day it might be, we're going to look at these interactive capacities and see, what does the child initiate? How does the parent respond? What does it take to have shared attention? How much back and forth is there? Is it embedded in pleasure or protest? Or we might see other things, that the child might be more avoidant or unresponsive or underreactive. And it gives us a chance to see what the child's solutions have been, because we know there are underlying issues that may be interfering the automatic development as we typically see it. And we can begin to raise questions in our mind. Okay, why is this happening? Parents try to find solutions to engage their children. Children find solutions to dealing with the world around them. And by examining this open-ended observation, we have our best chance of looking at where things are and a chance to see what we can do to facilitate more effective engagement, get more shared attention, you know, do the problem solving. And we can look at each of the levels. So our assessment approach is one, to observe what's there and then to see what will facilitate this happening. And that's where the intervention actually begins. It's in the assessment process. Now we may have questions about some of these individual differences that you outlined. And there we may go to a more formal type of an assessment to establish a baseline. Let's look at auditory processing. Let's look at visual spatial processing. What is the motor planning like? And that will give us not only an assessment, but also again a chance to think of how much specific therapy the child might benefit from and how to make that therapy again an interactive process for the child. So in each of these components, we're going to look at the functional capacities at each level. We'll look at some of the individual differences and perhaps bring in an assessment if we have questions about that area that aren't answered through the spontaneous observation. And then we'll put that into the context of the family and the relationship. So when we take a history, we don't only want to know when the child sat up or crawled or pointed, all of which are very important for understanding motor planning, but we want to understand how the child related and whether they followed cues and what kind of baby. And we'll often hear parents say they were such an easy baby, and that really may have been a very underreactive baby that didn't make demands, that didn't take in the world readily, but was easy, so to speak. Similarly, we might find it was a very fussy and sensitive and irritable child that was hard to soothe and hard to calm. So we take the history with the same perspective of looking at how that child was growing, you know, to the point that we meet them and see how they adapted, how they coped, what the family had to do to support that development. And that helps us understand where development might have been derailed or at what point, what else might have happened. So we want an understanding of the family, the history within the family, the relationships in the family, and how that child, what the world was like for this child in terms of the world he lives in and the parents live in. And that begins the process of thinking about how we can support this child and family better.
Yeah, I think you're highlighting important elements of the, you know, assessment process. And just to systematize a little bit, when we conduct an assessment in this new way, we always start off with, as you point out, observations of the child and the caregivers interacting with one another. And so watching and observing and even doing a little coaching for at least a half hour to 45 minutes, and hopefully doing it on more than one occasion, so you see the child at different times, is a cornerstone. And when we do this observation, we're in our own minds figuring out what the child's functional developmental capacities are, how well do they attend, engage, gesture purposefully, problem solve by using many gestures together, use ideas creatively or use ideas logically. We're seeing where they are in their developmental hierarchy. And then we're also observing their processing capacities. How well do they find things in visual spatial? How well do they follow directions or listen or understand auditory processing. How well do they speak in terms of expressive language? How well do they sequence and plan their motor actions? Are they overreactive every time mommy comes near? Are they instead craving and bunking into everyone,
right,
trying to get more sensory? Or are they underreactive and self-absorbing? So we're observing the sensory profile and the motor planning. We're observing their functional developmental level. And then we're observing what the caregivers and the therapist's natural inclinations are in working with this. Are they overstimulating the tactile sensitive child? Or are they under-energizing with the child who's underreactive, not engaging enough, not wooing enough? So we observe these patterns, and this is the beginning of the assessment process. Then as part of that, we do the history, and we go back to the beginning of the baby's life, often prenatally, so we want to know about health and nutrition and general status. And we monitor, after the baby is born, after we do the prenatal history, the child's mastery of each functional stage and find out what their processing profile looked like at each stage of their development up to the present. So now we have a roadmap of their development up till present. And then a very important component is sitting down and talking with the family, with mommy and daddy about their relationship in terms of their marriage, in terms of their relationship with other children and siblings in the family, and the dynamics of the family patterns, as well as the dynamics of the relationship with a child who has the challenges. And so we see the child's challenges now embedded in a larger family pattern, and sometimes there may be extended family involved, and we want to know about that also. And then in addition, we'll want to do a very careful biomedical evaluation, where we're looking at the child's medical history, but also assessing the child for the likelihood or possibility that medications may be helpful, and also to rule out any organic causes of the child's problems. Does a child have a neurologic disorder, a seizure disorder, for example? Does a child have a progressive developmental disorder where we'll need to do laboratory studies to nail down what the nature of that disorder is? So we want to do a very, very thorough biomedical evaluation to both rule out neurological and organic causes of the child's problems, as well as to explore the possibilities that medication may be an option as part of the future treatment plan. And then in addition, we always want to have our colleagues available to work, as you pointed out, in a focused way with all the different areas of functioning. Speech and language, pathologists to assess language and speech functions, occupational therapists or physical therapists to assess motor and sensory functioning. We need specialists sometimes to look at visual spatial capacities and perceptual motor capacities that are not assessed by occupational or physical therapists. And special educators are often going to be looking at particular areas of cognitive functioning. Neurologists, pediatric neurologists may come in, or developmental pediatricians, to again help assess the genetic basis for the child's problem or biological or neurological patterns involved in the child's problem. So there's a range of professionals that are going to be involved in this assessment, including obviously mental health professionals who are helping to do the family and the interactive assessments, working together. But in this approach, we don't just do everything for every child. We start off with the core clinical of the observation, the history, and the assessment of the family functioning. And based on the child's profile, we then decide whether we need an OT evaluation or a speech and language evaluation. Structured tests in this approach come secondly. Typically and historically, the old way has been child comes into a clinic, gets a battery of developmental tests after a very brief history. And the child who can't function well in these structured tests often gets assessed as functioning less well than the child can. We believe, as part of this assessment approach, you observe more than one occasion, and you try to bring out the best the child can do through some coaching in the actual assessment process. So you're seeing the range of the child under extreme challenges, where they may be functioning at the worst, and at the very, very best, where they may show more engagement or more interactive capacity. And frequently we see that. So that's our assessment. Then this then leads to a developmental intervention plan. And what would you think of as the highlights of our developmental-based intervention plan?
I think the intervention process will mirror this framework that you've just described, which will include the spontaneous interaction, what we call floor time. And this really has to be very focused. It means that 6 to 8 times a day, a family gets involved for 20, 30-minute sessions, or as long as the child can work, in following the child's lead, getting down on the floor, and supporting each of these functional developmental capacities. I think what's important here is maintaining that nice flow of interaction with them and keeping the child affectively engaged and helping the child learn to cue and interact, it's much more important than the content in and of itself. So in this part of our work, we're really trying to build a relationship, build the communication, build the affective range, build the emotional range, and to really hang in there. This may sound like a lot, but it's very important to spend the time doing this component, because that really fills in the foundation for children who may have developed higher skills but cannot really use them effectively and functionally to relate to people, to communicate, to play with other kids. And here too, by taking into account the different profiles of the children, we may use different approaches for each of the children, where a family can get support in learning how to interact with their child in a more effective way, and yet this is the work that really has to get done at home for most of the day, every day.
You want to give some examples of the way you would apply it differently to different sensory profiles?
Well, I think once we identify where the, we're using a developmental model. We want to build a structure. So if we see that there are weaknesses in the joint attention and the engagement, we want to just work on this nice affect cueing. We want to go back and forth. We want to build up a sense of pleasure. We want to help the parents, maintain a longer flow of just interacting in any way that they can, in any way that the child
and if this child
is
very underreactive to touch and sound.
So we would woo them. We would woo them very gently. We'd be soothing and calming if they get overloaded. But we'd have to bring a lot more energy to it, a lot more affect. That doesn't mean getting loud and gregarious, but it just means reading those signals very carefully and enticing the child.
Right, you have to use a lot more energy, a lot more wooing power to pull that underreactive child in.
Right, and use your voice and your looks and movement and hold that child in an environment within that relationship. If a child is more reactive and running all over the place and gets distressed and is tactily sensitive or overreactive to sounds, there we would use a more soothing and a calming and a quieting approach when the child may be disorganizing or fragmenting and can't just get things together. And again, we'd have the same exact goal, though. We want to have good engagement, sustain the interaction, and get a nice flow back and forth. Because without that, building on the higher symbolic levels and ideas and thinking just won't go very far. No, it won't last very long.
And during the floor time, we can be working at the higher levels for a child who's very verbal, who's already reading, perhaps, but is very rigid and inflexible and not very fully related. We can be working at the higher levels, playing an imaginative game or even talking about material from a book, but be very animated and very engaging and very regulating and very interactive at the same time. So we're working at all six levels through the floor time interactions. And that's what some people think, playing with a child is fun, but I've got to teach the child something. But here, pound for pound, minute for minute, you're getting more teaching when you're working with all six levels at once in this highly interactive way, because you can be arguing and debating with a child, well, why should my character, drive the bus? He wants to drive the airplane. Well, you have to drive the bus because I am the rulemaker and I said bus. Well, who made you the rulemaker? So in this kind of a debate, we're engaging, stretching, and working all six levels at once.
Right. By all means, we follow the child's lead. You know, if they're interested in Disney movies, if they want to, be an astronaut, if they want to do dinosaurs, we can go wherever the child goes. What really counts is the process. And one of the things about following the lead is to remember that the parent becomes a player, or the therapist, or the teacher. That we're not just going to walk around and ask questions, or we're just not going to walk around and describe what the child is doing. That we both follow the lead and become a player with the child.
The parent has to jump into the drama, become part of the action, either a character in a make-believe drama, or just the love object of the child in the wooing interaction. Mm-hmm. Or the fun noisemaker when the child presses the mommy's nose who makes the toot-toot sounds. So this is the spontaneous part. Then we have a semi-structured part that's often part of most intervention plans, a second part of the home program, often the school program. Do you want to describe the semi-structured part?
Well, the semi-structured part is really different in the sense that we create the opportunities for learning. We don't necessarily wait for the child to initiate it, although we may build on the child's interest. If it's a child who likes to do puzzles, or it's a child who has particular interests in building or books, whatever it may be. But here we create the opportunities. And there, again, we're going to approach this with the same issues that address you know, helping the child develop better language and communication, helping the child deal better with the visual, with the treasure hunt games, with being able to, you know, play with flashlights, helping the child with sensory motor activities, whether they're playing ball or chase or, you know, Red Rover. In all of these, we're creating the games. We're enticing the child to play individually with their siblings, you know, maybe with friends. And then, but here we have an idea in mind. We're going to select the games so that they meet multiple purposes. And in this way, we can also have the child get involved in 4 to 6 periods, activity periods a day, where we're playing these kinds of things, which will support any one of these underlying capacities.
Right, we can work on the underlying processing capacities, and we can work on emerging cognitive skills in a very semi-structured way, and even get somewhat structured sometimes. And this can be our agenda rather than the child's agenda,
right.
But we want to harness the child's motivation, so we make it a problem-solving approach. So any new concept or any new word we want to teach the child, like open, we put his favorite toy outside the door and help him imitate open to open the door. Then he's opening the real door to get his real cookie or real toy, rather than just labeling a picture, which doesn't have the same meaning for the child, and it doesn't generalize as rapidly. When the child problem solves and learns a new word, it generalizes immediately, we find. Whereas if the child just learns in a rote way, then they have to go to the next step of doing it in the real world with meaning and with affect. So we can teach the child anything we want, pretty much, within his range of capacities in a semi-structured or structured way if we create problem-solving interactions. We want to teach him up, his favorite toy goes up on the shelf. We can do imitative games, touch your head, touch your nose. We can teach him quantity concepts by negotiating for cookies. If we're reading and working on reading or early academic skills, we can read and then pretend, read and pretend, and then discuss the reading. So everything becomes problem-solving and meaningfully oriented, as opposed to just isolated islands of cognition. So this is the semi-structured component.
Yeah, I think that's the key thing, that whatever we want the child to learn has to be very relevant, very meaningful, and very useful. And we're not only teaching the content, so to speak, but we're really teaching the process of how to learn. We're teaching a language of problem solving, and what's the trouble, and what's wrong. We're mediating how to go about finding solutions. And that way we can strengthen that child's ability to learn on their own and function more independently.
So the child is learning specific cognitive things, specific motor things, but they're always learning it as part of a larger learning of problem solving, or what later becomes called for some of the older children, executive functions. So we're helping the child become a thinker and a problem solver all the time.
Right.
Now the third thing we work on is, as part of the program, often 3 or 4 times a day for about 15 minutes each, is a series of physical activities involving three types: running, jumping, spinning, deep tactile pressure, basically sensory integration, OT activities. Then a second physical activity involving perceptual motor or looking, doing games, throwing, catching, tracking, reaching. And a third physical activity involving spatial problem solving. This involves treasure hunt games, it involves hide-and-go-seek games, and teaching the child to solve problems through what they see and coordinating motor actions with what they see. And we like to do this not just in OT sessions of 3 or 4 times a week or even twice a week, but we like to do this daily, a number of times a day, because most of the children we see have severe motor planning problems, severe sensory modulation problems, and benefit from this foundation building approach. So this is a robust program that we believe should be the cornerstone of both the home program and the school program. Then on top of this, we often add on or have speech therapy many times a week, occupational and or physical therapy many times a week, depending on the needs of the particular child. Not every child needs both, but many children do. And then some children will need special visual spatial processing activities done by a specialist. Other children will require other kinds of work done also by a specialist. Educators may work with specific cognitive skills, but we would recommend doing it in a problem-solving way. And then also as part of everyone's intervention program is the biomedical component.
One thing I would add is that when the children have these individual therapies, what's so important is that these therapists help develop a home program so that they could feed into what we are calling the semi-structured program, so parents can practice these things with their children in an ongoing way. And that's where we can get the ideas to shape that semi-structured program.
Right. That's a very, very important point, mm-hmm. that the semi-structured component should be a team effort, mm-hmm. made up of the parents, the different therapists, mm-hmm. speech pathologists, occupational physical therapists, educators or special educators,
right.
Developmental pediatrician, if the developmental pediatrician is involved in the case. But this should be a team approach where the goals are set each week and they can be
right.
modified each week in keeping with where the child
right.
is.
With the parent participating in the therapy, so we really get a good back and forth flow going with a clear idea of what our goals are for
right.
the next week or two.
Yeah, and another component of the intervention program is peer play. Once children are engaged with caregivers and involved in a continuous flow of gesturing
mm-hmm.
and beginning to use a little bit of symbols and language, that's a perfect time to begin bringing in peer play so they practice these emerging skills with peers.
Mm-hmm.
And it should be a verbal interactive peer, and the parent or therapist may need to mediate.
Mm-hmm.
But 3, 4, even 5 times a week, we like to average around 4 times a week or more
mm-hmm.
for peer play so the children get used to interacting with someone else. As part of this comprehensive program. And then I was mentioning before, we always want to include the biomedical component. One, in the assessment to rule out physical problems, but also in the intervention side to see if there are biomedical interventions that may be helpful. Some children do very well in certain medications, and this needs to be assessed for every child, and some children may need to actually paradoxically develop certain skills, develop more language and more interactive skills, and then they graduate where medication
right.
may be helpful. But sometimes some medications can be helpful for a circumscribed problem, but not for a more global problem. And as children make progress, sometimes medication may have a limited role.
Mm-hmm.
We find that this is an important part of the overall program. Also, nutritional assessment and evaluation. Some children require elimination diets to help them regulate themselves better, and also can facilitate if they're better regulated, more better language and better interaction in some of the children. So nutritional evaluations are very, very important on an individual basis for the children. And then we have to keep an open attitude about the intervention process and consider what's going to be of special help to a child. Will a special gym class, will music be helpful? Rhythmic activities
mm-hmm.
are often very, very helpful. Other kinds of activity the child finds interesting. But whatever we're going to do and consider, and as new things emerge on the horizon, we always want to relate it back to the core. How is this going to help the child go up the developmental ladder in terms
mm-hmm.
of their developmental capacities? How will it help them resolve or improve some of their processing abilities, including
mm-hmm.
the capacity for just being better regulated? So we keep an open mind, but we relate everything back to a core, and we don't do anything in a fragmented or isolated way.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I think we're doing all the time is evaluating the overall rate of progress. And that for some children, they'll respond quickly and they may, you know, show very rapid gains. And other children work more slowly, but I think it's important to persist, even with children who work more slowly, with this overall plan.
Well, especially for children who move more
right.
slowly, we have to persist, because there we could easily
right.
lessen our efforts. We run into challenges.
Or move to much more structured approaches,
right.
which will really rob them of a chance to develop the range that they will most benefit from.
Yeah, and it should be highlighted that if you move to too structured an approach because
mm-hmm.
the child's progress is slow,
mm-hmm.
It's a little bit like throwing out the baby with the bathwater. It's a little bit, what you do is you add structure onto the semi-structured component. So a child
right.
who can't learn to imitate
right.
because they can't motor plan, we can do it in a very drill-oriented way. But that's only one component to help
right.
the child learn to imitate a motor plan
mm-hmm.
while we're still doing the dynamic interactive work.
Right.
So we don't lose the things the child needs to grow and develop, but we add on
right.
more structure for the children who need it. So some children in the semi-structured initially start out very, very structured
mm-hmm.
in that third of their program
mm-hmm.
and then graduate to more
right.
dynamic problem solving. So we want to keep an open mind, integrate and synthesize
mm-hmm.
the different emerging new insights and intervention. And in this kind of an intervention model, we don't have to close the door to any possibility. As new insights comes in, as new ways of interacting with children are learned, as new educational approaches and language approaches and occupational physical therapy approaches are learned, we could see how they relate to the core and bring
right.
in the elements in keeping with the child's profile. Now, we've talked about this in a very general, generic sense, but in the action of the real world, all these principles get applied very specifically based on the child's profile. Every child is different based on our assessment approach. And each intervention plan, while having some of these common elements, although not all for each child,
mm-hmm.
will be applied very differently depending on the child. And here's where we want to look at some cases. and some actual children to see how we apply these principles, particularly the floor time interactive principles and some of the semi-structured problem solving principles, in very, very unique ways.